فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. Generally, I personally don't like the majority of the times when you come to masajids and lectures are done, an introduction is always done about the speaker, a biography and who he is and his name. I don't like that. I don't like people referring to me as a sheikh. I don't like people giving an explanation of my biography. And that's why I didn't want to interrupt the brother and tell him to stop. But generally it is something I dislike and I hate it from the bottom of my heart, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. The topic that inshallah ta'ala that we'll be speaking about is the virtue of the companion. And when the brothers requested this topic, it made me very happy. It's a topic I truly love. And I believe it's a topic that is very important. It's extremely important. So inshallah ta'ala, today we're going to be speaking about the virtues of the companions and also the rights that the companions have on us. My beloved brothers and sisters, what I want you to all understand is the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose them. Allah picked them subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were not a coincidence to be of those who are around the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. They were actually chosen. And that is why Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, and this statement you will find it in Musnad Imam Ahmed, Al-Tabarani rahimahullah in his Mu'jam al-Kabir, and Imam Ahmed Shaki rahimahullah in Musnad Imam Ahmed, he authenticated it, and so did Shu'ayb al-Arna'ud rahimahullah. That Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, and it's a statement which is mawquf, meaning it's the statement of Ibn Mas'ud. He said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ نَظَرَ فِي قُلُوبِ الْعِبَادِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he looked at the heart of the creation. فَوَجَدَ قَلْبَ مُحَمَّدٍ خَيْرَ قُلُوبِ الْعِبَادِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he looked at the heart of the creation. And when Allah looked at the heart of the creation, he saw Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had the best of hearts. So Allah chose him subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَاصْطَفَاهُ لِنَفْسِهِ فَابْتَعَثَهُ بِرِسَالَتِهِ. Allah chose the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he saw his heart. From all of our hearts, Allah looked. And the only heart that stuck out for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that was the purest, that was the greatest, was the heart of who? The Messenger alayhi salatu wa sallam. ثُمَّ then نَظَرَ فِي قُلُوبِ الْعِبَادِ. Allah looked at the rest of the creation, their hearts. And he chose فَوَجَدَ خَيْرَ قُلُوبِ الْعِبَادِ قُلُوبَ أَصْحَابِهِ. After Allah looked at the remaining hearts, he saw that the companions were the best. فَجَعَلَهُمْ Allah تبارك وتعالى, he made the companions وُزَرَاء, ministers, ambassadors for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يُقَاتِلُونَ عَلَى دِينِهِ, who fight in the cause of this religion. So the companions were chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the reason why they were chosen, it was the purity and the nobility in which these companions had. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud also said, مَنْ كَانَ مُسْتَنَّا, anyone who wants to hold on to a people, فَلْيَسْتَنَّ بِمَنْ قَدْمَاتْ, hold on to those who are dead. فَإِنَّ الْحَيَّ لَا تُؤْمَنْ عَلَيْهِ الْفِتْرَةِ. The one who is alive, he can change. He can apostate. He can deviate. But the companions are the ones who are dead, who are gone. Their status and their rank is never going to change. So if you're going to hold on to a people, hold on to them. Stick to their path. أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابَ مُحَمَّدٍ. He says, أُولَٰئِكَ, those are أَصْحَابُ مُحَمَّدٍ. They are the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. كَانُوا وَاللَّهِ, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, they verily were أَفْضَلُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ. They were the best in this ummah. How were they the best? أبرها قلوبا. In terms of their hearts, they were the most obedient. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll see some examples. وأعمقها علما, and their knowledge was the best. They had the most knowledge. Anything that the companions have not commented or said in the Quran, for you to come and to add on to it is misguidance. Why? Because they are the most knowledgeable. The companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَأَقَلَّهَا تَكَلُّفًا قَوْمٌ اِخْتَارَهُمُ اللَّهُ لِصُحْبَةِ نَبِيِّهِ وَإِقَابَةِ دِينِهِ. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala chose these companions for a mission and a reason. The reason why they were chosen is to accompany the Messenger alayhi salatu wa salam, and also to establish the religion. So what should we do? فَعْرِفُوا لَهُمْ حَقَّهُمْ. Recognize their rights in which they have. وَاتَّبَعُوا and follow in what? فِي أَثَارِهِمْ, in their footsteps. Remember, they have virtue and status. Don't forget that. And also follow them in their footsteps. وَتَمَسَّكُوا بِمَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ أَخْلَاقِهِمْ. And also hold on to as much as you're able to from their manners and their etiquettes. وَدِينِهِمْ and their religion. فَإِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا عَلَىٰ هُدَى الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. They were on a straight path. So my beloved brothers and sisters, the first point that we learned is their companions were chosen by Allah. And the fact that we were not chosen is enough to tell us that we're not of their caliber. We're not of their level. We're not of their status. We're the ones who Allah chose to not be part of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, my beloved brothers and sisters, Allah referred to the companions as real men in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in Surah Al-Ahzab, وَلَمَّا رَأَى الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الْأَحْزَابَ. When the group, the believers, they saw them, قَالُوا هَذَا مَا وَعَدَنَا اللَّهُ. The companions, they said, this is what Allah promised us. This is the battle of Ahzab. وَصَدَقَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. Allah and His Messenger have told the truth. وَمَا زَادَهُمْ إِلَّا إِيمَانًا وَتَسْلِيمًا. What increased in their hearts was belief and surrender. They submitted more to Allah. This was in the battle of Ahzab. The companions, they saw the army coming. They didn't get scared. And this is the response they gave. They said, Allah and His Messenger have told us the truth. And in their hearts, their iman increased and they surrendered more to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, من المؤمنين رجال. From the believers are men, real men. صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَهُمْ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظِرُ وَمَا بَدَّلُوا تَبْدِيلًا. Some of them made a promise. They missed the battle of Badr. Some of the companions, they missed the battle of Badr. And they were very sad about it. And this is what they said. They said, Wallahi, if we live, and we got enough opportunity to be able to fight with the Messenger shoulder to shoulder, you will see what we will do. So when the battle of Ahzab came, they made a promise. Did they stick to the promise which they made? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا مَا عَهَدُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. The promise that they made with Allah, they stuck by it. They didn't turn. They didn't alter from it. They didn't leave it off. So the Sahabas, Allah referred to them here in the Quran, مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ truthful men. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, فِي بُيُوتٍ, in a house, which is the house of Allah, أَذِنَ اللَّهُ أَن تُرْفَعَ وَيُذْكَرَ فِيهَا اسْمُهُ. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala legislated and permitted for His remembrance and His words to be mentioned. يُسَبِّحُ لَهُ فِيهَا بِالْغُدُوِّ وَالْآصَالِ. رِجَالٌ لَا تُلْهِيهِ. Men. The remembrance of Allah and the praise of Allah, nothing gets in their way. When they come to the masjid, they're praying, they're fasting, they're doing khayrat. And they leave off their business. رِجَالٌ لَا تُلْهِيهِمْ تِجَارَةٌ. Trading and business does not get in the way of remembering Allah. They leave the dunya, they will forsake the dunya for what? The remembrance of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Allah says, رِجَالٌ مَنْ لَا تُلْهِيهِمْ تِجَارَةٌ وَلَا بَيْعٌ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَإِقَامِ الصَّلَاةِ. Whenever you see they're praying, they're fasting. Wallahi, brothers, There was an ayah, and Imam Malik rahimahullah, he brought out of it a very powerful benefit regarding the companions. Qawluhu ta'ala, the statement of Allah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ نَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ تَرَاهُمْ رُكَّعًا سُجَّدًا يَبْتَغُونَ فَضْلًا مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانًا سِيمَاهُمْ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثَرِ السُّجُودِ ذلك مثلهم في التوراة ومثلهم في الإنجيل كزرع أخرج شطأه فآزره فاستغلظ فاستوى على سوقه يعجب الزراع ليغيظ بهم الكفار. Allah tells us the companions were made ليغيظ بهم الكفار. So that disbelievers have hate in their hearts towards them. The companions, they're growing and their numbers becoming more. Was something that would place hate in the heart of who? And Imam Malik took from this, anyone who has hate towards the companions in his heart, is from the disbelievers. لِيَغِيرَ بِهِمُ الْكُفَّارِ. That's what the companions were there for. To have hate in your heart towards them, and Imam Malik rahimahullah, he said, it's a disbelief. It's kufr, a ridda. Ibn Abdul Barr mentions in his kitab, التمهيد, which is a sharh of Mawdha' Imam Malik. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran that the companions are khayrun nasi, they are the best of people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, kuntum you are khayra ummatin ukhrijat lin nas. You are the best of people, nations that were brought out. Abdullah ibn Abbas, turjuman al Quran, he said, hum ashabu Muhammadin. The people who Allah is saying here, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ ابْتِدَاءً. First of all, who is it? أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the companions of the Messenger. Of course, the rest they fall in, but the first people here, number one, is the companions. And there's a hadith that backs it up. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, خَيْرُ النَّاسِ قَرْنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ. The best of generation. Remember in the Arabic language, grammatically, if you look at the word khayr, khayr is siratul mubalagha. Originally, it used to be, بكثرة الاستعمال التكرار على اللسان, they dropped the alif that's meant to be there, it's meant to come in the sigha of af'al. It's meant to be akhyar, the best. Huh? Because it's been said so many times, the alif is dropped, so it became khayr. So the word khayr, it means the best. No one better than them. Oh, the companions. Khayrun nasi, the best of people are who? Qarni, my generation. Those who live with me, the Prophet says. Thumma alladhina yalunahum. Thumma alladhina yalunahum. Then those to come and then those to come after. And Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated that. Brothers and sisters, why did the companions gain that right? Why did they gain the rights to be the best of people? Let's look quickly at their life and what type of people they were. Examples will show why these people. Lidalik, me personally, when I read the companions' biography and their lives, and I study it, wallahi, they amaze me. I was saying it to the brothers when we were driving. I said, subhanAllah, the companions, sometimes they come across to me as robots, things that normal humans won't do. Normal things the humans won't do, we won't do. The Sahaba, the companions, the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did it without double thinking it. Like when they came to Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Abu Jahl, and the disbelievers of Quraysh came to the Prophet alayhi salat, came to Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and they said, أَسَمِعْتَ يَا أَبَا بَكَرْ, Abu Bakr, did you hear ما يدعي صاحبك, that which your friend is claiming, meaning the Prophet. He said, what did he claim? They said, he claims that he was taken from Mecca, and then he was taken to Bayt al-Maqdis, and then he was taken to the sky, and he met prophets. This is what your friend said. Do you believe him? What did Abu Bakr say? He said, wallahi, I believe him. Did he think twice? Did he think again and say, is that what he said? Really? Hajib. Is that what he said? Or straight away did he accept it? straight away accepted it. And he added on to it. He said, why should I believe this from him? I have believed from him something greater than this. What is it? I have believed from him. His statement of saying, revelation comes to me day and night. I've taken that from him. That Allah is saying to me, I've accepted that from him. And through that, Abu Bakr got the title of As-Siddiq. Radiallahu ta'ala. Wallahi, today if you look at the Muslims, you say, Allah has told you to do this. The Messenger has told you to do this. You see what? Wallahi, let me think about it. You know what? That was we're living in the 21st century. Does it apply to us? The Sahaba, straight away they believed it. لذلك الإمام أبي داود رحمه الله he brings in his sunan أبي داود he brings in his sunan that the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was addressing the companions one day talking to them عبدالله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه عبدالله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه was outside he wasn't where the prophet was talking he was where? He was outside Abdullah ibn Mas'ud heard the Prophet say to the companions that were around him, sit down. Sit down. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is outside. He's not in the masjid. He's not with the Prophet. He heard it from far. The Prophet saying to the people, sit down. What did Abdullah ibn Mas'ud do? He sat where he was. He sat outside on the street where he was. Before entering the masjid, he sat down. Why? Because the Prophet commanded. These are the examples of the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the type of people he nurtured alayhi salatu wasallam. إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَنْ يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. They were a people who believed if they were told to do something, I hear and I obey. No if, no buts. I am a slave. My master has told me to do something. I don't question my master. I do it. Jump how high? No questions after that. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's a hadith, Al-Imam Bukhari and Muslim both narrated. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was on the pulpit and he said the following. He said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَيَّرَ عَبْدًا Allah gave a slave a choice. بَيْنَ الدُّنْيَا Between this dunya, وَبَيْنَ مَا عِنْدَهُ There's a slave who Allah gave him a choice between this dunya and that which is with Allah. فَاخْتَارَ ذَلِكَ الْعَبْدِ This slave has chosen مَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ That which is with Allah. So the Prophet is talking about his slave, okay? Pay attention to who this slave is. فَبَكَى أَبُو بَكَرَ Abu Bakr cried. Abu Bakr cried when he had heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say this. The narrator of the hadith is Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He said, فَعَجِبْنَا لِبُكَائِهِ We were shocked with the crying of who? Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The reason why he cried, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, or Abu Sa'id al-Khudri said, is the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is informing us of a slave who Allah has given him the choice of this dunya and the hereafter, and this slave chose the hereafter. What's there to cry about? Abu Sa'id al-Khudri said, وَكَانَ أَبُو بَكَرْ was أَعْلَمَنَا the one who had the most knowledge. From amongst us. The reason why Abu Bakr knew everybody more, he knew the Prophet more than anybody else, and when the Prophet spoke what he was trying to say, is because he spent the most time with the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ When the Messenger saw Abu Bakr crying, he said, إِنَّ مِنْ أَمَنِّ النَّاسِ عَلَيَّ The person who has the most rights on me, the Prophet says, alayhi salam, fi suhbati in my companionship, وَمَالِهِ and in his wealth. The person who has the most right on me, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his companionship and his wealth, is Abu Bakr. وَلَوْ كُنْتُ مُتَّخِذًا and if I was to ever take a khalil, a person, a close ally, غَيْرَ رَبِّي other than my Lord, لَاتَّخَذْتُ أَبَا بَكْرٍ I would have taken it from Abu Bakr. In another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, every single person who had rights on me, I fulfilled their rights. I gave them what was their rights. Illa Aba Bakr, except Abu Bakr. Fataraktu mukafa'atahu lillahi. I left Allah to fulfill his rights. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I was very sad that makes a Muslim. Is this man who had this status, Abu Bakr? There is a people who slander him, who open their tongue in slandering him, calling him names. Shallallahu lisanahum. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala destroy their tongues. And may Allah hasten for them punishment in this dunya if he doesn't want to guide them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The reason why Abu Bakr was crying is because Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he understood the slave who Allah tabarak wa ta'ala gave him this choice between this dunya and the hereafter was the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The person who the Prophet was talking about, who had the choice between this dunya and the hereafter, and had chosen the hereafter, was himself, alayhi salatu wasalam. Umar radiallahu anhu came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one day, and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I love every single body on this earth, I love them, I love you more than them. My parents, everyone, my children, everything, except myself. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Abu Bakr, Ya Umar, your iman is not complete, Umar, until you love me more than anything, even yourself. Umar looked at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Umar looked at the Prophet and he said, Ya Rasulullah, la anta ahabbu nasi ilayya, you are the most beloved to me over everything, even myself. I love you more than anything. Al-Imam Abu Nu'aym al-Asbahani rahimahullah, he narrated in his kitab Hilyatul Awliya wa Tabaqatul Asfiya this powerful story. These are examples of the companions. Sa'd ibn Mu'ad, when the Battle of Badr was taking place, the Prophet consulted the companions. He sat them down and he spoke to them. When he sat with them and he spoke to them, Sa'd was the leader of his tribe. Sa'd said the following statements to the Prophet. After he consulted him, he said, Ya Rasulullah, O the Messenger of Allah, Imdi lima aradta, do what you want. Go forward and do what you want. فَوَلَّذِي بَعَثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ I swear by the one who brought you out with truth. لَوْ اسْتَعَرَضْتَ بِنَا هَذَا الْبَحَرِ If you take us to this ocean, the sea, فَخُطَّهُ And then you walk inside the water, in this water, لَخُضْنَاهَا وَمَعَكْ We will cut that water with you and we will walk inside it. مَا تَخَلَّفَ مِنَّا رَجُلًا وَاحِدٍ Not one man will stay back. If you just tell us, walk inside the water, I will drown. Wallahi, every single man from amongst us will go with you. We will not hold back, O Messenger of Allah. Another example is the story of Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one of the battles, and Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated, an arrow was thrown at the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he saw the arrow coming from far. And when he saw the arrow coming, Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he put himself forward for it. And the arrow hit him. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked and he saw the arrow sticking out from Abu Talha. Abu Talha looked at the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said to the Prophet, Dunaka ya Rasulullah, everything for you, O Messenger of Allah. La yusibuka sahmun, no arrow would ever hit you. So Abu Talha radiallahu ta'ala, he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do laka ya Rasulallah, la yusibuka sahmun min sihamihim nahri duna nahrik. He said, O Messenger of Allah, no arrow will touch you from the arrows of the disbelievers. My neck is before your neck, O Messenger of Allah. So the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they showed a lot of examples like this. In one of the battles, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companion, Rukasha radiallahu ta'ala anhu, in the middle of the battle, his arrow broke. Sorry, his sword broke. And when his sword broke, he came to the Prophet, he said, Ya Rasulallah, I have no sword to fight with. O Messenger of Allah, I have no sword to fight with. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, the Prophet broke a branch for him and he gave it to him. He said, fight with this. Wallahi, brothers, ponder, think. This is in the middle of a battlefield. People are fighting. Bloodshed. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives him a branch and he tells him to fight with this. He's fighting with this. Rukasha believes the Prophet so much, he doesn't question him. He takes the branch and he fights with it. The Messenger commands you today to do something. He tells you to do something. He tells you stay away from something. And here you are following your desires. You don't want to follow his command. He tells you obey your parents. He tells you to do this. He tells you to do that. You pick and choose what you want. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith Imam Ahmad narrated in his Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa said, the person who truly loves me the most, the one who truly loves me the most, is the one who will sacrifice his children. He will sacrifice everything, his money, everything will destroy it, just to see me. Not to spend time with me, not to sit with me and spend days and months and weeks, no, just see me and he's going to move. You will get rid of your children, your wealth, every single thing you own, just to one time see the Prophet. Some of you might say, I would do that, I would want that. But the truth of the matter is, if you would do that, then why is it that you don't want to look like him? You don't want to dress like him? You don't want to act like him? You don't want to... Why? If that's the truth. Brothers, wallahi, the matter of the companions regarding how the Prophet was, they showed us an example of how we need to deal with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Urwa ibn Mas'ud al-Thaqafi, after the battle of Hudaybiyah, after the Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, he went back. He went back to Quraysh. Urwa went back to Quraysh to inform them of what he saw. He said, O Quraysh, you sent me to Kisra and Qaisar, all the leaders. I was your representative. I went on your behalf. Urwa said, I never saw in my entire life a people respect their leader the way the companions respected the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I never saw anything like this. Hey, what happened? He said, Ma nakha nukhama. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not spit a spit. After he does his wudu, places the water in his mouth and then in his nose. And when he wants to squirt that water out, a companion would come and he would place his hand under the water that came out of the Prophet's mouth. فَدَلَكَ بِي وَجْهَهُ and he would rub it all on his face. These companions that you see, they will not surrender him easily. That's what he's trying to tell Quraysh. They might be little in number, but they will put every effort and hard work in making sure they protect him, alayhi salatu wasalam. Ikhwani and akhawati, my beloved brothers and sisters, loving the companions is the rights that they have on us. That we love them. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Hubbul ansari min al-iman. Loving ansar is of iman. وَبُغْضُهُمْ مِنَ النِّفَاقِ. Hating them is hypocrisy. You have to love the companions. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he also said, لا يحبهم إلا مؤمن. No one loves the companions except a believer, Ansar. ولا يبغضهم إلا منافق. And no one dislikes them except he's a hypocrite. There was one companion who was very old in age. Very, very old in age. When the ayah came down regarding his affairs. Pay attention. He left Mecca. And as you all know, the hijrah was not made obligatory on the elders and the women and the children. It wasn't made obligatory on them. This companion was very old in age. He took his shahada and he stayed in Mecca for a while and he looked around. He looked around and he couldn't see the companions, the other sahaba around him. His other brothers were in Medina. He was alone in Mecca. He saw the kuffar of Quraysh around him. He saw kufr and shirk spread around him. He said, Wallahi, I'm old, but I can't accept this. So he packed his clothes and his stuff and he made his way to Medina. فَجَعَتُ الْمَنِيَّةِ. Death came to him whilst he was on the path, on the road to Medina. And the reason why he left, he wanted to do bay'ah, pledge of allegiance with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But because he couldn't now, he looked up the sky, فَضَرَبَ كَفًا بِكَفٍ. He took one hand and he smacked it against the other hand. And he said, Oh Allah, هَذِهِ بَيْعَةٌ لَكْ. This is a pledge of allegiance to you. And he did it again, and he said, Oh Allah, this is to your Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَسَقَطَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ مَيِّتًا. He fell on the ground dead. And the ayah came down, وَمَنْ يَخْرُجُ مِنْ بَيْتِهِ مُهَاجِرًا إِلَى اللَّهِ ثُمَّ يُدْرِكُ الْمَوْتُ فَقَدْ وَقَعَ أَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. وَمَنْ يَخْرُجْ مِنْ بَيْتِهِ مُهَاجِرًا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ يُدْرِكُ الْمَوْتُ فَقَدْ وَقَعَ أَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Anyone who does hijrah for the sake of Allah and His Messenger, and then death comes to him, فَقَدْ وَقَعَ أَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. His reward is with Allah. Pay attention here, how the reward is not mentioned. Allah just said His reward is with Allah. And the statement is, Ibhamul Ajr, the fact that the Ajr has been left ambiguous is because it's going to be something big. When a king and a leader says to you, don't worry, I will reward you, are you going to expect something very small from him? No. Allah did not tell you this because something big. The reason he wanted to go and see the Prophet and give him bay'ah and live with him, alayhi salatu wasalam. This is the type of people they were, the companions. So one cannot hate them except what? Except to love them, radiallahu ta'ala anhum. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا تصبوا أصحابي. Do not insult my companions. Also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, من سب أصحابي. Anyone who insults my companions, فعليه لعنة الله. May Allah's curse be upon them. والملائكة and the curse of the angels. والناس أجمعين. And Imam Al-Tabarani narrated this. On the authority of Ibn Abbas and Al-Bani, classified it to be Hassan. Also, if you truly love these companions and you admire them, then follow them in their footsteps and the way where they were. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. Two people are mentioned here, and a third group of people. وَالسَّابِقُونَ. The sabiqun are who? The companions, those who came first. Allah explains to them, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ. The muhajirin and the ansar. Is anyone here from amongst us a muhajir and ansari? Yeah. No one here is a muhajir or ansari, right? No, we're not. وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ. And those who follow the muhajir and ansar. Can we be from that? رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. Those Allah pleased with. Three people have been mentioned here. Muhajirin, you're not. Ansar, we missed the opportunity. We're not Ansar. وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ. And those who follow them in good. So you want to be from radiyallahu anhu wa radu an, you have to be from those who follow them in their footsteps. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَىٰ وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّىٰ وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمْ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Anyone who diverts from what path, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَىٰ وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, and takes a path other than the path of the believers. You underline that point. A path other than the path of the believers. So what you need to do is to follow the companions in their path. Because why? They used to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Did they not? They used to follow the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said he used to walk like the Prophet. He used to walk like the Prophet. One time, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, there was a tree. There was a tree. The tree bended. And so if you wanted to go under, if you wanted to go forward on that road, you would have to go under the branch. So your head would have to go down in order to go. The tree got cut, or the tree fell, or whatever what happened. But the Prophet said, when he used to go there, he used to go down. He used to duck down. Alayhi salatu wasalam. The tree got cut, or it fell, whatever happened to it. It was not there no longer. Abdullah ibn Umar, whenever he went there, he would still duck down. He was still... There was a narration that touched me, I was reading the other day. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As. His father complained about him. His father complained about him. What did his father complain about him regarding? He complained about him regarding the issue of how much excessive ibadah that he does. So his father, Amr ibn As, came to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, my son Abdullah, I married him off to one of the best women of Quraysh. And this is how he treats her. All day he's fasting and all night he's praying. He doesn't give her rights. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As to come. What is this that your father is saying? He said, Rasulullah, that's my case. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, alayhi salatu wa sallam, to reduce on his ibadat, the fasting and whatnot. And the Prophet reduced it to the amount of the fasting of Dawood. And he wanted more. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to him, the best of fasting is the fasting of Dawood. كَانَ يَسُومُ يَوْمًا وَيُفْطِرُ يَوْمًا. He used to fast one day and he would miss another. So Abdullah ibn Amr ibn Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, he took the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's statement, and that's what he used to do. He wanted more because he had energy, he was young. But the Prophet told him, this is best for you because there might come a time in your life where you can't do this anymore. You become tired and fatigued. And that's what happened. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As grew very old in age. And he wasn't able to do the fasting he used to do when the Prophet was alive. He wasn't able to. But he didn't want to stop. So they asked him, why don't you want to stop? He said, I don't want to change from the way I used to be, and the Prophet used to know me in that way. I don't want to be different from it. Fakane, he was at old age. Fakane yasum yawman wa yuftur yawman. And he wouldn't miss it. I don't want to be in any way different to how I was when the Messenger knew me and how I was with him, alayhi salatu wasalam. That's how they work with the radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So that's why we follow them in the path that they tread on, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي وَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. هَذِي سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ. This is my path I call to. Is it only his path? No. And those who follow me. The companions are the first ones who follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says to us, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَكُونُوا مَعَ الصَّادِقِينَ. Those of you who believe, have taqwa, and be with those who are the sadiqeen, the truthful ones. Are the companions not truthful? They are. So they are the truthful ones that we have to be with. Also the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith of Irbad ibn Sariyah, وَعَذَرَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمَ مَوْعِظَةً وَجِلَتْ مِنْهَا الْقُلُوبُ وَضَرَفَتْ مِنْهَا الْعُيُونَ كَأَنَّهَا مَوْعِظَةٌ مُوَدَّعٍ فَأُوْسِلَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قَالَ أُوْسِيكُمْ بِتَقْوَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ وَالسَّمْعِ وَالطَّاعَةِ وَإِنْ تَأَمَّرَ عَلَيْكُمْ عَبْدٌ حَبَشِيٌّ فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ فَسَيَرَى اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ عَضُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِذِ وَإِيَّاكُمْ وَمُحْدَثَاتِ الْأُمُورِ فَإِنَّ كُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٌ وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. That's a riwayah of Sunan al-Nasa'i. In this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, عليكم بسنتي, upon you is my path. And the path of the Khulafa al-Rashideen, the rightly guided Khulafa, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Ali. That's the path that's upon you. You have to follow. We just follow it. عَضُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَلِدْ. Hold it down on your molar teeth. Hold down onto it. Their palm. Also, brothers, the rights that the companions have on us is أَن نُمْسِكَ أَلْسِنَتَنَا عَمَّا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. We hold our tongues from that which took place between them. We hold. We don't speak about what happened between them. So it enters into our hearts, anything towards them. ولذلك, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِذَا ذُكِرَ أَصْحَابِي, if my companions are mentioned, فَأَمْسِكُوا, withhold. This hadith al-Imam al-Tabarani narrated in his Mu'jam. Ibn Abi Zamanayn, he brings it in his Usul Sunnah. Abu Nu'ayb, he brings it in his Kitab Hilyat al-Awliya. Shaykh al-Albani authenticated in the hadith al-Sahiyah. So you will withhold from the companions and their affairs, and you do not speak about them except in good. What is very important is, and I did mention it before, is to take the path of the companions in their speech, action, and in their understanding. Brothers, the Ummah is going to be divided in how many groups? Yeah? 70? 73 groups. ستفترق أمتي على 73 فرقة. 73 groups. Are they all going to be in the hellfire? Except what? Except 72 are going to be in the hellfire, and what? One group is going to make it to Jannah, right? Yeah? One, right? Who is the one that's going to make it to Jannah? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من كان anyone who is upon ما أنا عليه اليوم وأصحابي. Anyone who is upon that which I and my companions are upon today. Pay attention. You want to be from that group that's going to make it? Yeah. Is that what you want? Just make sure whatever you say, whatever you do, whatever you believe in this religion is something that the Sahabas and the Prophet ﷺ believed. Something the companions and the Prophet ﷺ said. Don't come with anything new. The first question is, when somebody brings you an ayah from the Quran, you see there's many groups today, you just say to the person who brings you the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said this. So you say, okay, no problem. The ayah is an ayah in the Quran, I can't reject. The second question you ask is, who from the companions understood it like this? Wow. So, this ayah, I take it from the ayah of the Quran. But who understood the ayah means this from the companions? Are you with me? That's very important. The second question, when somebody meets you, قال الله and قال الرسول, the third question is, who from the Sahabas understood it like this? Because the Prophet commanded me, عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين. ومن يشاكك الرسول ببعد ما تبين له الهدى ويتبع غير السبيل المؤمنين. I was told to not follow the path other than the path of the believers. The believers are who? The Sahabas. So the way I know I am safe from any deviated group is قال الله قال الرسول قال الصحابة هم ذوي العرفان بل علم نسبك للخلاف سفاهة بين الرسول وبين رأي فقيه هذا. Allah and His Messenger said, that's what I want from you. And I want the understanding of the companions. I want Abu Bakr, how did he understand this ayah? Umar, Uthman, Ali, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Ibn Mas'ud. Are you with me? If the Sahabas have five different opinions in understanding of an ayah, if you take one of those opinions, you're still safe. Don't worry. You can't be blamed by anybody. Huh? There can be strong opinions within them, but you as a person who doesn't have much knowledge, if your opinion is held by a companion or some companions, you are still safe. Are you with me? That's very important. That answer, wallahi, is gold, gold. If you travel to China for it, and you came back just to get this answer, it would be a travel that's worth it. You understand the Quran and the Sunnah based upon how the Sahabas understood it. Good. Why do I have to understand according to how they understood it? Because all the other groups are in the hellfire except the group that are upon what they that are except the part of it. Sahih? Is that the case? Yeah, muhim, jid, muhim, jid. And also the qawl of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. مَنْ كَانَ مُسْتَنَّا فَلْيَسْتَنَّ بِمَنْ قَلِبَاتِ فَإِنَّ الْحَيَ لَا تُؤْمَنْ عَلِي الْفِتْنَةِ أُولَئِكَ أَصْحَابَ مُحَمَّدٍ أَبَرَّ هَذِي أُمَّةُ قُلُوبًا وَعَمَقُهَا عِلْمًا وَأَقَلُّهَا تَكَلُّفًا اخْتَارَهُمُ اللَّهُ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى لِصُحْبَةِ النَّبِيِّ فَاعْرَفُوا لَهُمْ حَقَّهُمْ وَاتَّبَعُوا عَلَى أَثَارِهِ فَإِنَّهُ كَانَ عَلَى هُدًى مُسْتَقِيمٍ. The Sahabas were the most knowledgeable and the most greatest and the most noblest. I think inshallah ta'ala, I'll conclude there with Ibn Kareem. I've spoken a lot, and the best of speech is that which is to the point and summarized. Anything which I had said that was wrong, mistake, a shortcoming in the topic that I was speaking about, فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي وَمِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ وَاللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ بَرِيَانِ مِنْ. It's from me, الشَّيْطَانِ, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. They have nothing to do with it. My mistakes. I also wanted to mention, my beloved brothers and sisters, as a final conclusion is, as you're all aware, and you all know, the situation that's taken place right now in Somalia right now, the drought. Young kids, animals, people, wallahi, are dying. And what they need from us is number one, dua, supplication. And the second thing that they need from us, my beloved brothers and sisters, is financial support. Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam requested for aid and support for the jihad, and Uthman came and he gave, and then he came and he gave, and he came and he gave, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and he bought a whole wealth for the believers, bi'ru ma'una, he bought it radiallahu ta'ala anhu. What did the Prophet say? مَا ضَرَّ مَا فَعَلَ الْعُثْمَانِ بَعْدَ الْيَوْمِ. Whatever Uthman does today onwards, it doesn't harm. Wallahi, brothers, Allah gave it to you today, this money, to test you with it, to see how you're going to use it. The money that you really own is the money you give. The Messenger came to Aisha one day, and she said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, food was brought for us. The Prophet said, what's left from the food, the meat that was brought? He said, Ya Rasulullah, everything is left, except the shoulder. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam corrected her, and he said, no, the shoulder is left, and not the rest. Sorry, the rest is left, except the shoulder now. Because the shoulder is what they brought for him. Brothers, wallahi, pray for your brothers, put it in the basket, inshallah ta'ala. Support them and aid them. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is going to give you better. I'll take the microphone.